So welcome to our session tonight. My name is Peta Lindsay, and I'm with the UCLA History Geography Project, and this is our session Reading and Writing for Justice. We're going to get started with our land acknowledgement. So as a land grant institution, we always begin with a land acknowledgement. And I did give you all, you should have a copy of the agenda. The agenda does have a link to the slides presentation. So if you look at the notes on this slide, you'll actually see some resources for if you want to do land acknowledgements with your own students and some other kind of related interesting resources there. But just to get us started, as a land grant institution, the UCLA History Geography Project acknowledges the Tongva Gabrielino peoples as the traditional caretakers of the unceded land originally known as Tombengar, currently the Los Angeles Basin to the Southern Channel Islands. All right, we think we can keep going. So this slide is just explaining a little bit about who we are. So many of you are familiar with us, many of you worked with us before, but for those who haven't, we are the UCLA History Geography Project. And we operate under these two organizations. So we are part of the Center X at UCLA, and we are also part of the California History Social Science Project, which operates throughout the state. Here's oops, let's go ahead and, sorry, I got a little distracted. Here's our mission statement down here. It says collaborating with teachers to make history relevant and empowering for students. And that's really important. You know, we see ourselves as collaborators. We understand that teachers, you are the experts. You know your communities, you know your profession. We are here to support you, and help make your teaching more impactful. We do have a copy of the agenda that Amps just dropped into the chat box. It's very helpful. Thank you so much. And if you want to click on that copy of the agenda, you can get to your own copy of the slides that we're looking at tonight as well. And we will be asking you to kind of click on some materials in the slides. So it would be helpful to have that open. Yep, and there goes the sign-in sheet and all of that. Great. All right, let's go to the next slide here. Okay, and so here's the slides where we can introduce ourselves. So again, I kind of got us started here. I'm Peta Lindsay. I am the Associate Director at the UCLA History Geography Project. If you worked with us before, you probably knew our really great Associate Director, Cindy Mata, who came before me. She is now the Director down at UC Irvine, but that gave me the opportunity to step into this position. Prior to this, I was a teacher at Venice High School. I was teaching U.S. History, Ethnic Studies, and African American Studies at Venice.
And thanks, Peta. And my name is Danny Diaz. I am the director of the UCLA History Geography Project. Before this, I was a high school teacher. I taught high school history for 13 years, and I've been here at UCLA for almost 10 years. Go ahead, Ams.
Here I am. Sorry. Hi, everyone. I was trying to let people in the waiting room. I am Amparo Chavez Gonzalez. Most folks call me Amps, especially if Amparo is hard for you. I appreciate Amps. I've been an educator for 33 years. I've taught everything from 3rd through 12th graders, and I am really, really excited to be here learning with all of you. Thank you for joining us.
Great. And we have,
Sorry, and please sign in for us. This is the way that we document that we serve you and we apply for grants. So please sign in for us. Sorry about that, Peter.
oh, no problem. I was just going to say we're also going to be joined by Ben Wong a little bit later. He is not here at the moment, but he will be stepping in, and he is one of our coaches. All right. Should we go to the next? And this slide is just introducing some of our teacher leaders. We are always looking for new teacher leaders. So if you'd like to work with us more extensively, we always need people to help us kind of innovate, design curriculum, participate in these forums and things like that. So please let us know if you'd be interested in working with us as one of our teacher leaders. Here are some of the teacher leaders. If you've worked with us before, you may have gotten the opportunity to work with them in the past. And I think some of you are here tonight. Oh, no. All right, let's go next. All right, and this is our faculty advisor, Dr. Kelly Little Hernandez. And I highly recommend if you've not had a chance to check out her scholarship, we're very proud of being able to work with her. And she's done some really excellent scholarship about California history, really centering ethnic studies, people of color, looking at the police state, and things like that. And just be aware that she is the faculty advisor for the UCLA History Geography Project. One more time, we're just going to ask for that sign-in. As Amps mentioned, it is really important for our record keeping. This is how we get funded. And so please do sign in if you are able. There's a QR code. There's also a link on that slide as well. All right, we can go to the next. Here is our agenda for the evening. You should have a copy. We did link a copy in the chat box, so you should be able to access it there. If you look at those links at the top, there are links to all of the materials that we're going to be working with tonight as well. All right, and let's do community guidelines. So before we get started tonight, we are going to ask, you know, for these, we are going to go over some community guidelines. You know, we are all here to learn together, and we just want to make sure this is a good experience for everyone. So we are going to ask you to mute your audio, but turn it on to speak. There will be moments when we ask you to turn it on to speak. To whatever extent you can, please show us your beautiful faces. We know it's been a long day, but it really helps with being present, with connecting, if we can see each other, especially when we go into those breakout rooms. Please do try to turn on your camera. Let us see your face if possible. We don't do safe spaces here, but we do brave spaces. So we're going to ask if folks can be brave, open, and caring is kind of what we look for in these spaces. To the extent that you can, please be an active participant. If you have questions, please drop them in the chat box. Please participate in the break rooms. You know, let us know where you're at. Have an open mind to everything you hear tonight. And, you know, take what serves you and practice self-care. You know, if you need to stretch for a minute, if you need to run to the bathroom, please take care of yourself. That's important to us, too. And if you have tech issues, please let us know. If anything comes up, especially in the chat box, is really helpful if we can help you over there. OK, let's go to the next. All right. Let's start with our cultural energizer, just a way for us to kind of start talking to each other and come into the space together, start reflecting on our own education experiences. So tonight we are talking about, you know, culturally responsive, culturally sustaining education. And we want to think about this question, if you wouldn't mind putting the question up. When you were in school, when you were experiencing your K through 12 education, did you see yourself in the curriculum when you were in K through 12? And if so, would you mind talking about that a little bit? If not, when was the first time that you saw yourself in the curriculum? I know for some folks, it can be a little bit later. Let's think about that for a second. Maybe let's do maybe 30 seconds thinking about it, and then maybe waterfall in the chat box, if you wouldn't mind sharing some of your experiences, some of your reflections. So maybe let's take 30 seconds to think about the question, right? All right, that was 30 seconds. Do we think are folks ready to share? Can we all try to share in the chat box maybe some of these experiences? Maybe we can talk about it for a second. All right, not until 12th grade. All right. Okay, we can start looking at some of these. So a lot of folks are saying college. So Chavez Ravine came up, okay, Learning Tree. Not at all. Would anyone like to share? I mean, we could, oh, absolutely, seeing some more in the chat. We could maybe have time for if anybody wants to put on their mic, and maybe if we could keep our comments down to like 1 minute or less, but if anyone wanted to share over the mic, we could talk about this for a sec. All right, I'm seeing someone say individual teachers made a big difference. I think that's why we're all here tonight, right? We know that teachers can can have an impact.
Did you want us to unmute and share?
Sure. And would you mind saying your name?
Hi, I'm Valerie. Super happy to be here. I mean, we were introduced to ancient China in sixth grade, right? Part of world civilization. But then I didn't feel like that was a representation of me as a Chinese American present in present times.
Interesting, yeah. So did you feel like you ever got that representation?
In junior, my junior year when we read the Joy Luck Club, but I feel like that's now just, it's everybody's go-to to learn about Chinese Americans.
Right. So there, but the, so it's very shallow. It's very limited. So we're still dealing with a lot of these challenges for sure. For sure. Thank you so much for sharing. For sure. One sentence about the Armenian genocide in high school history. I'm seeing in the chat box for sure. Yeah. So a lot of us have had, we've had some kind of mixed experiences on this, right? And so it kind of makes us think about why it's so important what we're doing here today. And I just want to go back to that one comment in the chat box where a student or somebody mentioned that they, you know, this wasn't part of the official curriculum, but they did have individual teachers who were working with them. And so, you know, we do have a lot of power here in terms of shaping these experiences for students and helping our students get the kind of education they deserve. So something to think about as we continue forward. Thanks so much for sharing, folks. Why don't we keep going? All right. So tonight we have two main goals, two things that we were trying to set out to accomplish today. We want to explore the connections between rigor, literacy, engagement, and action civics, and culturally relevant and sustaining pedagogies. And we're going to talk more about those terms, what they mean, and what they look like in our classrooms. And we want to give you all resources, right? So we're going to explore resources that are culturally responsive, relevant, engaging, and rigorous, right? And we said, you know, this is Black History Month. So we're doing a special focus for this meeting on local African American history. All right, let's keep going. So with that said, we actually want to get right into the activity tonight. What we decided is that first we're going to do the activities. So we're going to do one of these activities using our culturally relevant sustaining pedagogy and content. And then we're going to go back and talk about what we just did and talk about some of the shifts in the instructional framework, talk about some of the kind of strategy and theory behind what it is that we're doing. So we're going to start right off with the first literacy strategy. And that one is the 7 C's, which is a strategy to help us with critical thinking and historical analysis. So what are the 7 C's? Let's look at what it is. If you click on, so you should have access to the slides. Remember, the slides are linked through your agenda. If you click on that 7 C's icon right there, you should be able to get to the 7 C's document itself. It is going to ask you to make your own copy, so everybody's getting their own copy, right? But you can see in there what the 7 C's actually look like. Let's go back to the slide. So what is this? It's a tool. It's a means to build critical thinking skills in students. And it's a scaffolded way to develop critical thinking skills, develop language, and develop writing. If you look at what the 7 C's actually are, the way that this form is set up, let's go back to the form. What you would do is you start with an inquiry question, and then you can have a text, and it can be any kind of text or image or video, and then have students respond to that using these 7 C's. And so if you look at the 7 C's, it's things like check it out, then connect, contextualize, corroborate, right? So it starts with the very obvious things, check it out, what do you see? And then we move into contextualization, right? So you start with the lower order thinking skills, then you're moving to higher order. But then we don't just leave it there. Like, we start with contextualization and cooperation, which is important, but then we also start bringing it into the realm of social justice, of action civics, and we start looking at criticality, which is a really important element of that. So then we're also examining this text, analyzing this text, this image, this video. We're also looking for criticality. We're looking for power, who or what seems powerful in this source. And we go beyond that to a call for action, showing empathy and solidarity. So then we get students to think about, how does this source help us understand how others lived and felt, right? And at the end, you have your conclusion. So you've looked at the source using these questions, and then you bring it back to that inquiry question. How does this source help you answer the inquiry question and drawing evidence from there? So if we can go back to the slide. Again, what you would do is use this as an opportunity to have students practice speaking and listening as they're building critical thinking skills. You could have your source text and you would give them the 7 C's and you could have them talk about it. You could also use these as writing prompts, right? So it's a way to develop a writing skills as well. You could use these for smaller chunked writing. If you'd like to go to the next slide. We do have, you know, there are these questions and skills are connected to the literacy standards in a lot of ways. And on this slide, if you look at the bottom of the notes of the slide, we talk about the specific standards from which you can find the connection to the 7 C's and how you'd use it in your classroom. But it connects to the reading and writing standards. It connects to the Common Core speaking and listening standards, but also the English language development standards. Like, this is a great tool for developing language and giving students more opportunities to use language in the classroom, which is key for developing language. Next. All right, so we're going to do a 7 C's activity. We're going to have you all look at some sources using the 7 C's, and we're going to analyze in small groups. So this activity comes from a lesson, and that lesson is linked on that slide. So if you'd like to see it where it says lesson, it is linked by Marissa Matek. It's a third grade lesson that asks the question, how can we create our own narratives to foster the stories of our community? And this lesson was produced as part of our Lost LA curriculum. So it's a companion lesson with a PBS TV show episode of Lost LA about the Shindana Toy Company. And so this lesson was made to go with this TV show episode about the history of this toy company, the local Los Angeles toy company. And we're going to use some of the sources and some of the video. We're going to use some excerpts from that lesson. So on that slide, I've linked the whole episode. If you want to go back and look at that later, it's a really interesting local history story, but we're just going to get a little bit into it for this activity. So if we can go to the next slide. All right. So we're going to talk about this lesson is focusing on the Shindana Toy Company. And what is the Shindana Toy Company? We're going to talk a little about it. So this is a toy company that was founded in 1968 in the aftermath of the Watts Rebellion. And it was part of something called Operation Bootstrap, which is something that came out of really the civil rights movement in the 1960s and how that developed specifically in Los Angeles. But it was really about responding to a very particular need in the community and that need when it came to children's toys. So we have an article that explains as well, but why don't we take a second and watch a little video? We're going to watch a 2-minute video about Operation Bootstrap. And if you wouldn't mind thinking, maybe you can respond in the chat box. As you're watching, maybe put one interesting thing that you saw in the video. Or if you have experience with the Shindana Toy Company, some of you might have heard of this before. Some of you might be experienced with Operation Bootstrap. Go ahead and tell us about that in the chat box as well. So we're going to take a second and watch this video now.
At the library, there were these archival materials on Bootstrap.
This is one of the pieces that helped to say, hey, we're here, to the community, you know, come join us.
Yes. And this is your late husband, Lou Smith.
Yes, he ran everything. Yeah. Basically, he's the person who interacted with businesses and community people and tried to bring them in to the idea of a job training center that we wanted to open. We wanted to involve as many people in the community, particularly young people, in advancing their own careers.
This was the slogan of Operation Bootstrap, right? Learn, baby, learn?
Yes.
So where did that come from?
Shortly before Operation Bootstrap was opened up, there was the uprising in Watts, and the slogan there was burn, baby, burn.
Burn, baby, burn.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We took that and made it into a more positive thing.
Learn, baby, learn. That sort of summed up the attitude of Operation Bootstrap.
Yeah, it summed up the attitude of Lou Smith and Robert Hall. Both of them were very savvy political people. Lou Smith was a national figure because he came from Congress of Racial Equality in New York City. We met during Freedom Summer in 1964 in Mississippi. I'd just gotten pulled into the civil rights movement. He was somebody who had actually come up through the ranks of the civil rights movement, and he had learned from it. He was always looking for ways to do something about the racial impasse in America, the whole idea of racism in America, and what to do, what is a black person to do about it.
All right, let's stop and talk about that clip for a second. Who here has heard of Operation Bootstrap before? Has anyone heard about it before? Can we talk about that for a second? Is it something that's ever come up in your school curriculum? If anyone wants to put in the chat box, maybe your thoughts. I just wanted to bring it up because I think this is one of those things when we teach the civil rights movement, a lot of times it ends up focused on kind of the Southern freedom movement or focused on the Deep South. We don't look as much at what was happening in Los Angeles and that really important local history. And so it's, you know, something interesting to know. And I think it'd be very interesting for students to know and realize that you know, this movement was happening here and in the forms that it took. All right. All right, and thanks some folks for chiming in on whether you've been taught this or not. Okay, so let's keep going with this activity and we can talk a little bit more about the activity we're gonna do. Okay, so I pulled some sources from this lesson on the Shindana Toy Company, and this is again from a lesson for third grade students. Oh, here we go. Okay, so folks are chiming in. Yeah, so not something we'd heard about before. Great, well, I'm glad we're learning about this tonight, right? It'll be great, and hopefully you can share it with your students. But we're gonna look at some sources from this lesson. And what we're gonna do is put you into small groups and you'll get some documents. You're gonna look at the images in the sources that we gave you, choose somebody to write down your group's responses, and then respond to the questions that accompany the source together. Can we go to the next slide so we can look at the sources that we're looking at? So what you're going to look at are some images of some dolls, right? And so these images are, we have some dolls that existed prior to the Shindana Toy Company. Source A is kind of representing some of the problems that were being dealt with and then how those problems were addressed with sources B and C is if you want to know kind of the overall flow of the lesson. But if you click on any of those source images or if you click on the title at the top of the screen, you should be able to get to the document and you should have an image. and some seven C's questions. All right. So we're going to put you into small groups, and we're going to ask you to pick one of the sources and discuss it. Just go through it using those documents, and maybe one person from your group could write some thoughts down. We're going to set up those breakout rooms. About 5 minutes in, we're going to drop some discussion questions in your breakout rooms as well. We're going to ask you to kind of step out of the activity, evaluate as teachers, and think about some other discussion questions as well. All right, I think we're ready.
All breakout rooms are open.
All right. Welcome back, folks. I apologize for the messed up links. Oh my gosh, I had flashbacks to teaching on Zoom. That totally felt like the Zoom teaching moments. I'm really sorry about that. Hopefully we were able to get to the right links. Hopefully you had a little bit of time to use the seven C's to look at the how it interacts with the material, to look at some of those sources and kind of some of the interesting resources we're offering. I was hoping we could have a little bit of debrief discussion about the activity we just went into in the chat box. I was wondering if folks would want to give some thoughts about it, how it might apply in your classroom, or how do these questions encourage historical critical thinking skills? What do you think about how do these questions encourage common core skills, or how do these questions promote social justice and civic engagement? If folks want to think about that for a second and maybe put some thoughts in the chat box, or any kind of reactions at all, was this interesting to you? Do you think this is something your students might be interested in? Is this, history you're familiar with? Is this interesting to learn? Let us know. So let's take a second, maybe do some thoughts in the chat box. If anyone doesn't want to talk, doesn't want to type and would like to turn on their mic and maybe say something, you can let us know. Nice. Thank you, Jose. Absolutely. So I'm seeing questions that put the onus of investigation reflection on the students. Absolutely. And something you can be used across the curriculum for sure. Thanks so much. Let's give another minute or two before we move on. All right, any thoughts about the content? Is this anything that you had seen before? Anything you think your students might be interested in? Anything that might apply if folks are ethnic studies educators, especially?
I have never heard of this, but it was very interesting for me and my group. We had good discussions, so I really enjoyed it. And we went through all three images and just hearing different perspectives and age ranges was really, really interesting for me to engage with. So thank you.
Does having so many questions intimidate students? That's a great question. This can absolutely be scaled down or up. So if you just wanted to put one question in each box, if you just wanted to use maybe not all seven of the seven C's, if you just wanted to use a few of the C's, you could do that too. So it doesn't have to be a lot of questions. It could be, this one is very easy to chunk this tool if you're concerned about that.
And we made it with that purpose in mind. So for you guys to think about, what I begin with, just check it out and maybe connect or contextualize, would I later on build on more of these for my students? Depending on the sources that I'm using, I might want to take out a couple of them, right? And so you can work it that way. You can also work it so that you have different students answering different squares, right? And so they're working in a group. You guys did it all together looking at one source. So there's lots of different ways for you to think about how to scaffold this up or down, make it shorter, make it a longer activity. And one of the things that we're really interested in is thinking about how does this connect to civic engagement and social justice? And we'd love to hear from some of you your thoughts about that as well.
That's really interesting. In the chat, thanks Gregory for chiming in on this idea of Operation Bootstraps and kind of addressing that problematic notion, right? And doing that community investment. Thank you so much for sharing, and thank you Amps for jumping in there as well. All right, I think that is it for that. So hopefully you all got a tool that you can use and some interesting kind of local history there. We're gonna keep going. Actually, I think the next part. Oh yes, we're gonna keep going. Okay.
Hi, everyone. And so we want to share with you how this activity and this literacy piece that we developed, not only the content, but the literacy really connects to the ways that we are informed at the History Geography Project and why we do what we do, right? And first most, and you should all know that we're all former school teachers, so we rely a lot on our teaching experiences with students of color and other in other communities. We really, really, you'll hear us talk a lot about our students. And for me, that means that my students are now middle school teachers and parents. They're in their 30s, but I still, you know, think fondly of many of them when I first began. We do a lot of collaboration with schools and historians. We talk a lot to historiographers and historians, anthropologists, musicologists, who tell us about the latest things in their field, and they come and they share it with us, right? And then we try to find ways of bringing it to you. We think about what the latest pedagogy is, right? What are people telling us that we should be thinking about? Of course, we rely on Common Core standards. I'm known as the literacy crazy one in the group. I can quote Common Core standards. And we are the authors of the California History Social Science Framework. And so we think a lot about what it means to use that framework as we develop some very mindful and intentional teaching pieces. Next slide, please. And so for us, the framework really invites teachers to shift the way that they're teaching by thinking differently about the content they use. And for us, that really means thinking about how do we think about content and inquiry and literacy and citizenship in a way that gets us to bring up rigor, engagement, connection to local history and community, and to have kids learn in the service of doing, right? Learn in the service of helping others. And so for us, those are really, really important, as well as we want more historians. So we want to build kids to be doing history and thinking about history in ways that we like. We always talk about our geek crushes. So we want more people to geek crush on incredible historical figures that we love to think about. Next slide. Danny.
Thank you, Amparo. So yeah, the all the stuff that we're talking about, these instructional shifts and the things that in, you know, the bullet points that inform the work that we do and the way we approach our work, a lot of it is centered on the history framework that came out in 2017. As Amparo referenced, the California History Social Science Project are the primary authors of that framework, and we don't believe that the framework, we believe that the framework is a definite improvement on the 1998 standards, but we also feel like the framework still has areas of growth, as we like to say. And I think one of the things that we're trying to do along the lines of what Amparo was talking about is sort of plug in some of those holes with some culturally responsive and relevant and local historical content, in addition to building those key literacy skills as cited by the framework. The framework also talks about equity and access in history social science classrooms, directly references this in chapter 20, and saying, and you know, that we know as teachers of history and ethnic studies that there's plenty of opportunities to culturally, to align our classrooms culturally and linguistically. And so just know that the framework is encouraging this.
And so when we think about what is some of that latest pedagogy, right, we have been thinking a lot and learning a lot about culturally relevant education, culturally relevant pedagogies, right? And we know that our good friend at UCLA, Professor Aleem, and his colleagues recently wrote this called culturally sustaining pedagogies, right? And what does that mean? And if we go to the next slide, we're going to look at that. Danny likes to remind us that this is from Gloria Billings, Ladson Billings. This is the remix of culturally relevant and responsive education. And this is really what it means for it to look like in the classroom, right? What does culturally sustaining pedagogy look like? We want to invite you to take a look at this slide for a minute. And then we're going to ask you for some reflection on it. We'll say about 30 seconds, maybe 45, because it has a lot. It's a lot to process in this one slide. All right. We'd like you to think about, where do you see this happening in your school settings, whether it be in your classroom, in the culture of your school, in the culture of your community? Where do you see this culturally sustaining pedagogies appearing for you in your school or community? And if some of you want to unmute, we'd give one or two folks a chance to share. People want to put in the chat, we'd more than happy to read those out loud and share with the others. We have a shy group tonight. Come on, we know a whole bunch of you, so it's okay to pat yourself on the back a little.
I'll share.
Go ahead.
I think it was, oh my God, is it Peta? I don't want to butcher your name.
Peta.
I'm sorry, Peta. Yes, Ms. Lindsay. She mentioned criticality, and I immediately thought about Dr. Godi Muhammad. So I'm with LAUSD, and we have a Black Student Achievement Plan. And again, with all the ethnic study courses, right, we're using her lesson plan templates. She's spoken to our HEAT schools. She's been a guest speaker. And it's just really revitalized, personally, how I lesson plan. And I'm familiar with Dr. Ladson Billings, but it's made me, her lesson planning has made me like go back to just reading Dr. Ladson Billings' work, like Dream Keepers, and also Dr. Alfred Tatum, who's Dr. Muhammad's mentor. And so all these things just intertwine, and it's just given me just a lot of innovation and drive to just go back to old lesson plans and, you know, jazz them up and, you know, just make them more relevant, because, you know, our kids are constantly changing. There's a youth culture. You know, it goes beyond just race, but it just makes you just a better practitioner, because you got to consider a lot more and just really be on your toes. So I'll share that.
Thank you. Yes, right. There's a lot of, when we're talking about those languages and literacies and cultural ways of being, young people have all sorts of different cultures and subcultures, right? And most of us cannot keep up, right? But I think that that's also part of that conversation, that it's across race, it's age, it's intergenerational, it's community-based, right? There's some communities that are very much into the arts and music, and there's some communities where they're all about the skateboarding, right? So how do you know the kids in your community? How do you connect with what they're doing and what they're thinking about? And what does that look like in your classroom, right? It might be as simply as acknowledging that there are kids in the community, and there's a center for young people where they go and they talk to one another and receive services for social emotional issues, right? Sometimes it's as simple as connecting kids to content and to resources in the community and inviting them to look out and to go check them out, right? And at other times, it's really having conversations with community about, what do you want from schooling? What should it look like? How can we invite more parents to come in and be a part of those school communities and school conversations about what we want? So thank you for that. Can we go on to the next slide? And so Here, I also want to invite you. A lot of folks don't know about this law. If you've ever done anything with other times of the UCLA History Geography Project, you know, this is one of those public service announcements that we always do, right? And so I want to invite people to please take a look at the FAIR Act and think about, again, how does this FAIR Act, that is a law in California, affirm, confirm, challenge, or invite you to reimagine how you approach teaching in your classroom? For that, I know you guys got opinions, so come on now, let's put some in the chat, right?
Can you repeat your question?
Put it in the chat, my dear. Yeah, someone already gave us some stuff, right? That it's affirming to a teacher to know, like, hey, I'm in the going in the right direction. I'm sharing materials that connects to the particular students that I work with, right? I'm validating students, right? And I'm trying to include all sorts of voices in there. So thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Gregory. Right? Yes, and their histories. Anybody have any wonderings about this FAIR Act? This is where we can be brave and caring and open with one another. Any wonderings? We might have mostly secondary teachers, which don't usually have too many or difficult with wonderings with this one, but sometimes people do. Right. Yeah, how do I was waiting for someone, right? How can students see themselves? And I think for me as a teacher, what folks are saying in there is, how do I make sure I offer other voices? Where do I find that content? Where do I find those other voices if I'm not sure I know about them, right? I can tell we don't have any sixth grade teachers because they're usually the first ones that are like, how do I do that in ancient civ? You know, they always have like that question, right? So yeah, where do I find these if I'm not familiar with them, right? How do I collect these stories that are both empowering and my students can see themselves, right? And also connect and make connections across communities. So I think that that's an important question that as teachers, we continue to ask ourselves. And when people come into our classroom and ask us why this content, we also have this FAIR Act to support that expansion of content that isn't always visible in the textbooks that we use. So thank you so much. I believe someone else comes after me now. Thank you, Danny.
Thank you, Amps. And I'm seeing some more comments here in the chat box. Thank you all for engaging with us that way. One of the final things that we wanted to talk about is going back to this piece about literacy, which definitely, as Amparo was saying, has a culturally relevant and sustaining component to it. What we encourage history teachers to do is to have students explore what it's like for them to do history. To kind of do some of the work that scholars do, and that is looking at primary sources, scaffolding, giving them scaffold opportunities and strategies that allow them to engage with complex texts, moving beyond the textbook and helping students really grapple with some good inquiry questions using evidence from historical documents and secondary sources to create, you know, claims and arguments. Right. And as it says here, we believe that this really helps to develop a historical consciousness in our youth that will help them, better experience the world around them in the sense that they can make sense of what's happening by comparing it to the past and using what they've learned about the past to help them inform decisions that they make about their communities in the present. So with that, in the chat box, we're going to ask you to revisit the seven C's and let us know where you see some, if maybe you see or experienced examples or evidence of doing history, culturally responsive and sustaining pedagogy, the FAIR Act. Thank you for those comments, Trevor. Mm-hmm. Erica, it is important to find the stories that empower, celebrate, highlighting resistance, hope. Thank you for that, Dana. All right, folks, we're going to let you marinate on that. And so feel free to unmute or add to the chat. We're going to invite you to take a break right now, little stretch break, giving you an opportunity to maybe grab something to drink, a snack, take a quick stretch because we've all had long days. And I believe I want to check with the team first because we are running a tight ship here tonight. how much time? Well, we're going 5 minutes for this. All right. So I see 5:28 on my clock, and that means we'll be back with you all at 5:33. And so we'll play some music, and when you hear that music stop, that's kind of your cue, your audio cue to return to your computer so we can resume. All right, y'all, enjoy your break. Grab a snack. We'll see you here in 5 minutes.
And I just wanted to welcome everyone back from our break. My name is Ben Wong, and I am a history coach with the UCLA History Geography Project. And just a little bit about me, I wasn't able to join us earlier at the introductions, but I've been working in education for 22 years now. And for the past 9 years, I've been working as a history instructional specialist in one capacity or another with Green Dot Public Schools and also with UC Irvine. And I'm happy to be here with the UCLA History Geography Project and sharing some of my passion for the work and for history social science instruction. And one thing that we're going to jump right into right now would be our second literacy strategy for the evening, HAPPY. And just a quick introduction on our next slide, you'll see the acronym for HAPPY right here. And it stands for historical context, audience, purpose, point of view, and why. And what exactly is HAPPY? HAPPY is a protocol that allows for teachers to provide direct, guided, specific instruction for students. When it comes to reading historical sources, it provides a goal for students to work towards, but it also allows for students to work collaboratively and also practice their speaking and listening skills. So it does a lot of things, and it's very straightforward, and I love the acronym. I love acronyms. That being said, on our next slide, we'll see some specific literacy standards that connects HAPPY with what students are going to be practicing with regards to speaking, listening, and reading. And also, again, our approach is friendly towards English learners. So that's a consideration that's always top of mind in working with our local populations. And one thing that we also want to tie into here is with our content standards. And for today's demonstration with HAPI, we are going to be working with an 11th grade standard. And this is the end of the school year kind of a thing, where when I was teaching 11th grade US history, I almost never got to. And I'm sure that we've all been there at some point. But 11.7 asks students to explain how the federal, state, and local governments have responded to demographic and social changes. And I'm turning that into an inquiry question here for our evening together, as how do we repair past racial injustice? And going back to FAIR Act and culturally sustaining and responsive pedagogy, we are going to talk about presenting an honest and age-appropriate account of history. And this can be difficult for some of us. And something to consider here would be why talking about the past and being critical of it is hard. And it's hard because it's uncomfortable because of some of the implication that it raises, not just about the past, but also about the present, right? So that's something I want us to keep in mind as we continue our conversation together. So on our next slide, one of the things that I want us to really start with is a quick reference guide here on what we're going to be doing. And the most important thing that we should be doing as educators here is laying that groundwork for controversial issues to be discussed in class. So this isn't something that we're necessarily going to be doing in the first month of class until we've worked on building community, established norms, and knowing yourself and knowing your students, right? And again, the ultimate goal here is whatever you're discussing in a safe, structured, and academic way. And that's something that I found really helpful to do. And again, you have the link for you to reference. There's a lot of resources here. I don't wanna spend too much time on this, but again, some quick things to consider as you embark on this with your students. So, as I said, we're going to get right into it. And one of the things to consider here would be California and its relationship with Black Americans. Now, many wouldn't make the assumption that California is progressive, but there is a long history of racial injustice in California. A lot of the conversations may be around contemporary racial injustices, but this is something that has been with California since its founding. And a couple of resources that you can click on the slides there and include the founders of LA, many of whom were Black Mexicans. We have Pio Pico, who was of Black ancestry. So those are important considerations to consider. And you're taking a look at some of the links right there. And you know, to move a little bit further on our next slide, you'll see that the United California in particular was complicit in slavery and Jim Crow. California's enforcement of the Fugitive Slave Law of 1850 is something that is not often mentioned in history classes. We consider also how in all over California, we had recorded examples of lynchings of Black Americans, and also how a lot of this is concealed from not just students, but also us as educators, right? This may not be something that we have grappled with necessarily in our classrooms, and certainly not by me. And just sharing one other resource for us to consider, this is the Gold Chains resource from ACLU, and they have a ton of content here as it relates to slavery and Jim Crow in California. And again, just the amount of resources there is well worth pursuing given the time that you have. So bringing us all back into the present, this was from last May. We do have a House Resolution 414. And just navigating through all of this, the top headline was that Congresswoman Cori Bush of Missouri put out a bill that would call for $14 trillion in reparations for Black Americans. And that number in and of itself is mind-boggling. And I taught econ for 8 years, and I spend a lot of time in my econ class looking at social justice, and the topic of reparations has come up. And I would say that $14 trillion undercounts the amount of labor put in by enslaved people. So going back from 1619 up until 1865, I've seen calculations come up with a number of $92 trillion worth of unpaid labor extracted from Black people as a result of adjusting for inflation. So again, this is a conservative estimate, but a lot of things to consider here. And taking a look at why I bring this up, right? On our next slide, we'll consider some historical context here. And I'm putting all of this out there because I know that we're going to be diving into our activity in a little bit. And this is all set up in context and introducing the topic that not all of us may have complete familiarity with. But I do want to emphasize again how we got to where we are today. And that's with starting with the failure of Reconstruction, Jim Crow laws, and continued de facto discrimination that's created an enduring racial wealth gap that's excluded Black Americans from sharing in that economic progress of the past 80 years, right? We also want to consider that many Americans have a huge misconception of what that racial wealth gap is. So for example, a professor at Yale, Michael Krauss, found that almost 70% of Americans believe that Black Americans on average hold 90 cents to the dollar of the wealth of a white household, when in fact it's 15 cents on the dollar, right? So that's something to consider. And that might lead to our second to last bullet point here about why most Americans would be against reparations. It's because they don't know what the actual racial wealth gap is. So when we consider all of this, I want to just celebrate that last link there. I think that there's a lot of data that's out there about racial wealth gap. And I think that's, again, personal issue that's important to me, but I'm putting that out there for all of us to consider. Especially when we look at contextually and historically where we are going back to the seven C's, right? So with all of that being said, let's take a look at how HAPI works. So on our next slide, we are going to go through some of the steps, and you are going to be working in breakout rooms in groups of four. And first things first, we're going to start with the historical inquiry question. And the historical inquiry question, again, is how do we repair past racial injustice? And then on our next slide here, you're going to get access to the link of the source set. So click on the source set and have that open and ready. So I see a bunch of us on there already. Thank you. And then you're going to get an opportunity to look at the different historical investigator roles. So let me just, hold on, I got to update the link here. So we do have four roles for our work today. So within your groups of four, you're each going to choose what you're going to do. If you're going to investigate historical context, if you're going to look at audience, if you're going to look at point of view or purpose. So all of that would be something that you'll decide amongst yourselves. And then also of note here is on the next slide, you'll see a screenshot of our graphic organizer. You can make a copy of the document that we're going to share in a little bit to show you how to piece it together with your groups. And again, something to consider here is focusing on the specific roles that you have. And I'm going to put the links to our, the links aren't working. I got to fix this.
And do you need us to work on the permission so you can continue to present?
No, it's on slide 45. It should be good. I just copied and pasted the wrong spot. So let me just do that first. Sorry about that. So we have the historical investigator roles on that first link right here. And then we also have our graphic organizer right here. So again, there are some specific guiding questions for each of the different historical investigator roles. So keep that in mind. What you would want to do next is within your groups, you're going to use the guiding questions under your investigator role, and then give yourself a chance to read and give that a quick read with the source. And on slide 46, you will see the breakout rooms and the source that you've been assigned. So if we can get the breakout rooms set up, I'll be visiting each of the rooms just to make sure that everything's okay, but we'll get that set up and we're gonna spend about 10 minutes in our groups together.
Are you ready? Can I open them?
Hold. Yes, we are.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Hi, welcome back, everyone. I'm sure like many of you, we were cut off in mid-conversation, and part of it is just because the documents are so rich with different facets that we can really spend hours talking about, right? So a few things to consider as we begin our debrief. First things first, if we take a look at some of the discussion questions right here, and feel free to turn your mic on and give some context to where you are with it. But I do want us to start with the last question on the slide right here in front of us, which is how do you envision adapting the HAPI protocol with your students, right? What's some things that you need to do?
I would just say when I teach American Lit, and I mean, it's now contemporary comp, but first semester, I'm like, wow, I wish I had this strategy, you know, this mnemonic. I wish I had it because, you know, when we're looking at, like you said, primary sources, sometimes, you know, they're so archaic, it's hard for our students to really, you know, break them down and see the connection. And I think this would have been great. So I look forward to using it, well, if I teach 11th grade next year.
Oh, and yeah, thank you for sharing that. And I think the consideration would be with modeling. Like, what are some specific steps of HAPI that you would need to model with your students? And I was in a group that read the Case for Reparations and published in 2014. And Trevor shared out his wealth of knowledge and experience about what was happening in 2014 and conceptualizing that. And that made me think about, well, my kids in high school right now, they were still playing with Pokemon in 2014. They don't necessarily have the historical context to fill in some of those gaps. So what would I do? I'd probably model that example with students before they dive into the reading so that it helps them get situated a little bit better. And to David's point right here, you know, it's similar to HIP or HIPPO from AP that's used there. Again, not the only strategy, but again, certainly something to consider. Going back a little bit now with our first bullet point, what are some considerations for how you can lay some groundwork for respectful communication with your students? What are some specific things that you do in terms of building community and fostering an environment that is open to these conversations? So Erica has put into the chat some concrete expectations with students, and that's really helpful. Are there some specific examples that you can share with us? Oh, co-creating expectations, really important. Are there some specific examples that you would want to share out? So collaborative activities like jigsaw, scavenger hunts, those are really good at working on building community. So something for us to consider. I know that it's late in the evening, but I do want us to really just consider those concrete expectations. I think that safety is built through clear expectations and thinking about how students might feel in your classroom if they're not sure how and when they would be able to speak up or share in class is really important. And then to Hera's point about some specific activities where you can lower that effective filter among students in order to start off with some low stakes conversations and get to know each other. Because again, once you can start really building that community, you'd have that opportunity for students to just feel more comfortable with talking in class. And again, some other great points right there for us to consider. And Gregory is just dropping lots of knowledge in the chat right there. A lot of great stuff. On that note, and if you've been with me in other sessions before, you know that I'm famous for my awkward transitions. And here comes one of them. We are going to spend a little bit of time in an awkward transition to our next slide, which is going to be on the state seal of civic engagement. And again, going back to, I will revisit reparations and Black history in a little bit, but again, putting all of this into context right here and why this is important for all of us in our work is the state seal of civic engagement. So the state seal of civic engagement is in it is a seal that is affixed on high school graduates' diplomas, provided they meet certain criteria, and that criteria allows for students to practice a couple of the skills that we do have available right here. And one of the things that's come up in my work on, and you'll see this on the next slide here, is with where we are in society and why the state seal of civic engagement is important. Because regardless of where you stand politically, people have specific needs that they find unfulfilled by government. A lot of people would say that the social contract has broken down. And what are we doing here? And one of the things that the Civic Engagement Research Group out of UC Riverside has discovered is that by connecting people to their community, we're better at becoming civic actors, Right. And being agents for change. And that's something that we are looking specifically when it comes to civic action and the state seal. And we are looking at action civics, and it's learning for the sake of serving, not necessarily just community service, because this is going to include a couple of things that are possibly going to work on engaging our students in a different way. And if we take a look at the next slide right here, we do have our criteria, and this is from the State Department of Education. So these are the criteria. You can take a look at the state website on our next slide here with some specific references, but we wanna make sure that our students are going to be prepared to participate in our pluralistic and democratic society, right? So a couple of things to consider would be what that would look like. And again, all of us here as practitioners, as teachers of history, social science, we're taking a look at how we can engage students in rigorous academic work, make sure that they have a competent understanding of the Constitution. They're taking a look at participating in a civic engagement project. And they're looking at utilizing their skills to solve real world problems. And then there's also that self-reflection, because knowing yourself and knowing where you are within the fabric of society is something that we should really spend more time on, I think. And that will help us be more civic-minded and foster that commitment to impacting not just our community, but also the world beyond the classroom. That being said, on the next slide there, we do have some resources. And with Danny's comment right there in the chat, you know, that criteria can be demonstrated during 12th grade, but with how the CDE has laid out their criteria, students can start earning that certificate beginning in 9th grade. So that's something to consider right here. And just calling out a couple of resources that we have would be, like I was mentioning earlier, the CDE has a lot of information on their website. LACO, the LA County Office of Education, also has a document there that shows how civic learning can be done, not just in high school, because a lot of people think the state seal is just a high school diploma thing, but for us to consider that students should be participating within their communities in an active and engaging way, not starting from kindergarten. And then lastly, we want to highlight the California Serves grant program that's available. The deadline's coming up sometime mid-March, but that's something for a local education agency to partner with an institution and work towards developing some resources and materials for their school districts. Now, all that being said, I do want to close out my section on our next slide with a quote from John Lewis that was, he wrote a letter, an open letter to America right before his passing in 2020. And I just want us to take a look at the quote right there. I'm not gonna read it out loud because I cannot embody his voice, but I do want us to take a look at it and really think about what all of this means with the world that we inhabit today. So what I would like to invite all of us to do is to put a response to to the quote right here with a question that you may have as it relates to civic action or civic engagement. Any questions that you may have, we can try to work on answering some of these. Ooh, democracy is an act. It makes me think of the Benjamin Franklin quote that he was asked, "What did you just create in writing the Constitution?" And Franklin says, "A government, if you can keep it, right?" And it requires a constant tending of the fire to maintain this pluralistic democracy that we have, right? Everyone, every generation must do its part. Beloved community, love it. So on our next slide right here, I think this should show up for all of us. All right, thank you. So we do have a menu of civic engagement projects that we've shared with other teachers before. And again, thinking about where we are with the case for reparations for Black Americans, these are all things that students can participate in. And I'm just thinking about going back to my 11th grade history class and having my students write a letter and email to a member of Congress to move forward on HR 414. Because again, if you want to really consider what we must do to enact social justice in the country, we need to first acknowledge the harm that was done. And again, Cori Bush has not necessarily said that the $14 trillion is attainable, but it is something to start the conversation on, right? If we want to repair harm, we need to acknowledge that something happened. And I think even a kindergartner would be able to articulate that. You know, you say you're sorry, but also why, and contingent on that promise to not let it happen again, right? So I think that's an important activity that your kids can do. You can also work on creating an informational poster to close that misperception gap on the racial wealth gap about what students think they know versus what they actually know, and just build awareness around certain issues. But this menu here can be used for a whole bunch of other activities. And taking a look at Beverly's comment in the chat there, that every generation must do its part. And I think this is an opportunity for us to pass on that responsibility to our students. So on that note, I think we have our closing.
Absolutely. So on that previous slide, there were some examples of more lessons and materials if you want to check out some more resources that we have related to local history, related to African-American history. We hope we were able to give you some useful strategies, some useful content tonight. If we can go to the next slide. This is just, you know, ways to keep in touch with us. So if you want to check out our website, look at our curriculum, our YouTube, social media, please stay connected. And then the last thing we have for tonight, we want to give you some time if we go to the next one. Okay, ooh, I don't see the evaluation. We'll drop the evaluation link in the chat. It should have been on that slide. I apologize. But for the last thing for today, we are going to give you a little bit of time to fill out our evaluation. And so these do matter to us. We would love to hear your feedback and hear what you thought about tonight and how you might be thinking about using these strategies in the future. So thank you so much tonight. And let's make sure that we fill out that evaluation. And let's just check. Okay, it's there. And we can drop it in the chat. So there's a link to the evaluation form in the chat box if you were not able to get it earlier. Okay. You know, while you're filling that out, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I don't know if my colleagues would like to say any final words before we, or if anyone else would like to say final words, any appreciations for anyone you spoke to tonight, anything you heard tonight.
Yeah, thank you, Peta, for running a great workshop. My shout out is to you for running a great workshop. You and Ben did a really good job. And all, you know, my breakout room colleagues in room four, we had a good time looking at document D. So I really want to send a shout out to them as well.
So any other shout outs, appreciations, you can drop them in the chat, or if you're busy filling out that evaluation form, we appreciate that too. So please do that. And thank you all so much for coming tonight. Should we put on music? I don't know. Thematically appropriate music goes with the strategy.
And then we also want to plug our next session on March 21st. We hope to see everyone there as well. And if you get a chance, feel free to spread the word to colleagues or other friends.
Absolutely. Thank you all so much.